Tracy. I'm project manager of the Boston Redevelopment Authority. I'd like to acknowledge some of my colleagues in government tonight. Maria Lanza from Mayor Walsh's office of Neighborhood Services is with us, as well as Patrick Lyon from Rep. Aaron Michaelowitz's office. Is there anyone else on this? No? We also want to acknowledge outfitwaterfront.com is going to be filming the meeting tonight. This is our second pre-file impact advisory group meeting for a project that's coming before the Boston Redevelopment Authority at Lewis Wharf. I think most of you know of it, but we're going to go through it in detail tonight. So very basic background on the project. The only thing submitted to the Boston Redevelopment Authority at this point has been a letter of intent to file a project notification form. The BRA expects to receive a project notification form from the performer next week. That will kick off a 30-day public comment period. We will put every document we receive based on the project up on our website. So that should be up on our website, I'd say Tuesday or Wednesday next week after we receive it. We'll also hold another impact advisory group meeting in the next couple of weeks. We will advertise that in the local papers. We will put that up on our website. We will blast that out on Twitter. Shortly after that, we will hold a public meeting open to all North End residents, anyone else who wants to come. That will be broadcast in the local papers, put up on our website, broadcast on Twitter. Everybody who signs in tonight and leaves your email address will get an email notifying them of those meetings again. Please sign in on the sign-in sheets that are circulating and leave your email address. That's most pertinent for us going forward. That's how we're going to communicate with you going forward. This is subject to Article 80 large project review. All projects coming before the City of Boston of over 50,000 gross square feet are required to have large project review on the Boston Redevelopment Authority. As part of our Article 80 process, as I just touched on, we have an impact advisory group. The impact advisory group is sitting at the front table tonight. These folks were put on this advisory board by local elected officials. So I don't mean to diminish the voice and opinions of the public at all, but these folks are very important to the process. They serve in an advisory role to the BRA. They help us understand the impacts to the community. They help us understand mitigation, community benefits, and what should come out of the project. And they help us determine whether we should bring it forward to our board for approval. Obviously, the public is extremely important in this process, too. And your feedback is extremely important in helping us decide whether we should bring it forward to our board for approval or not. The BRA is committed to being as thorough, transparent, and as open as possible on this project. That's why we decided to take the extra step in the process and have two impact advisory group meetings before they file their PM. This is not required under BRA policy. Some folks have said it's unprecedented. I wouldn't say it's unprecedented because we're doing it in another project we're doing it now, and I know we've done it on many projects in the past. It's a bit unusual, but we do it on projects that we know will be important to the community, that we know will have big impacts, and we know will have a wide range of opinions from folks in the community. We wanted to be as thorough as possible. That's why we had an extra process to the front end. The reality is, if we didn't have these meetings, they could file right away, and it would basically start them on their way on that 30-day clock. In reality, we've not held them up, but we've made them go through this extra layer on behalf of the community, because we knew how important this would be to the North End and the North End water. That's why we've done this. Pre-file IAGs, as you can see, have morphed into a bit larger crowd, and that's perfectly okay with us. In fact, it's worked out well because it's given us an opportunity to show the entire community what's coming down the pipeline so there are no surprises. So we're actually quite pleased with how this has turned out, getting a great crowd back in August and a great crowd. The VRA is not showing this to you tonight as a ringing endorsement or saying it's set in stone. All we've told the proponent is that we are comfortable enough for them to file the project with us. Then we're going to go through the process and decide whether we want to bring it to our board for approval or not. As I said, it's not set in stone. The process vets the project, and we decide if we'd like to ask them to change a piece of the project or approve it or not. Your feedback throughout this is critical. We need to know how you feel. We need to know whether you support it, you oppose it, you like certain points, certain aspects of it, or you don't like certain aspects of it. Your feedback is critical for us. Everything we hear tonight, we're going to take back and work with senior staff and our other colleagues at City Hall. And then every public comment received, once we open up that public comment, period gets read by VRA staff, we read every letter that comes in, and we consider that, and that all goes into a few different factors that help us determine what we can bring forward. Other factors are how our elected officials feel about it, so you feel free to write your elected officials, let them know how you feel about it. So since the first meeting, which happened August 12th, the plan has not changed. What we've asked them to do is to further develop the plans and answer some of the questions that you brought up, both the IAC and the public, at that first meeting. We heard some good constructive feedback. We've asked the proponent to respond to that tonight, but the overall parameters of the project have not changed. I just want to touch on scheduling very briefly. In late July, we threw out two dates to the IAG members of when they'd like to meet again. We heard no conflicts, so we set a date. We understood later that it conflicted with a NURA meeting. We apologize for that. I've talked to the head of NURA, and we have committed to him that we will not hold another meeting that conflicts with NURA or any other North End group going forward. You have our word on that. Okay, I think that's all I have now. I just please ask you to respect this process that we have tonight. What we're going to do is I'm going to hand it over to the development team. They're going to run through the project. We're going to open it up to the IAG. They're going to have the opportunity to ask any questions, get any comments off their chest. Then we'll open it up to the greater public. And we have a room until 8:30, so whatever on your mind until 8:30, we would like to hear how you do. Anything that you can't get off your chest tonight, you don't feel like you have time, you don't want to ask in the crowd, you can absolutely email me. If it's for me and the VRA, I'd be happy to answer it. If it's for the proponent, I can forward it to the proponent and have them follow up with the answer. So I just ask you to respect the process. Even if you're not crazy about the project, please ask you to respect the process and respect how the meeting is going to work. Okay, I think that's it for me. Yep. Two IAG members weren't here last time. Some other members. You know, I've asked them to, if they can, in the sake of time, expedite the points they can feel like they can expedite. But there were some members who weren't here to be on this one. So at this point, I'll hand it over to the attorney, Daniel Toscano, ask him to introduce his team, and then run through the slides.
Chris, thank you, IAB members and members of the public. I want to thank Dick Tucker for taking me in here tonight. It's our second IAG meeting. No time is of the essence, so what I want to do is just introduce myself. Daniel Toscano, I'm an attorney and a member of the development team. I'm just going to go through and introduce the development team, Will Adams.
Look louder, please.
I'm sorry, Will Adams, who's JW Capital Partners, DJ Moriarty, JW Capital Partners. We got J.D. Clancy, the architectural team. We got Ron Weiss from the zoning attorney. We also have Liz Burns, who's here to provide a little more analysis on our transportation study. So what we heard over the last meeting was a couple of big issues. One being the traffic. So we're going to talk more in detail. Liz will talk more in detail about the traffic and the traffic analysis that we've been done. And Liz will go over that at an early time. Will is going to go over the project whole. We'll try to do it quickly, because most of you already heard it. There's a few folks that weren't here. The other issue is open space. Can we get more of the development or landscape of what the open space maybe was like? We have some ideas. Will touch upon the open space. One of the other major issues was asked of concerns with the dimensions around the surrounding areas of the building. So we got we'll talk about the dimensions and we've gone out to see to measure all of the existing buildings in the surrounding area. And I'm sure we'll get new concerns, new issues, and we're more than happy to address them. But before we start, we have the members of the IAG. And as a fact, we just give your name, please, and just no need to tell us where you're from. We already heard it. But just give your name, just so we can put names in the face and then you can continue to do so. We can start with the IAG members.
Jason
Miriam
Pott.
Steve,
this is
Leon.
Eddie
Could you stand? Could you come closer to the back? We can't hear you back here at all.
Yeah.
It's very, very muddled. Maybe if you came towards closer this way, we just can't hear.
All right, well, I'm going to introduce Will, and Will's going to take over from
from here.
If you could come closer.
Well, I can sit with you if you want.
You can what?
I can sit over there.
You can sit over there.
Is that better? All right, so we just turn it over to Will Adams, and we'll go through the plan and address any concerns.
Hello, I'm Will. Can everyone in the back hear me?
Yes.
Yep. Okay, and I'm sorry I'm talking over your backs or Ed's here, but if you guys can hear me fine, just speak up and I'll try to keep turning this way so you all can hear us as well. My name again is Will Adams. I'm the JW Capital Partners. We're proposing the hotel at Lewis Wharf, as you all know by now. So what we're going to do tonight is walk through the slides that we went through on August 12th, about a month ago. And I'm going to try to do it with more brevity tonight so that folks that want to get out of here.
Who saw it on August 12th?
There was a IAG meeting on August 12th. Another one tonight. There's going to be another one in a few weeks. Then the public process starts. I don't want to speak for Chris Tracy, but that's my understanding. So for those, how many folks did not see this presentation last time? So the question really becomes, so for those folks who raised your hands, would you like me to go through kind of in great detail on this? I know we're more focused on the IAG here, but I'll defer to Chris and the IAG.
I think it's most important, history of the site, I don't think it's quite as important as the project before us. I try to focus on the project before us as opposed to the history.
Sure. So the outline of the previous presentation, we go through the existing conditions, some site history, Harbor Park plan, which was a process that the city went through with the community in the 1980s and early 90s. There was a previously approved project for the site that incorporated a hotel. Then we'll go back to the existing conditions, our current proposal, comparing it to the previously approved project. And then we will address some of the questions and concerns we heard out of the last IAG meeting. And we will then turn it over to the IAG. So I will try to go through this a little quicker than I did last time. So for those of you who are familiar with the site is comprised of about 9.3 acres. It includes these dilapidated pylon fields. It includes land all the way up here. It circles around all the way to the surface parking lot. This is the site plan of it, and as you can see, the current terra firma, other than this area, for the most part, is pretty much covered with paved parking areas for a surface parking lot. The site, as I said, extends significantly out into the water. These are the two pylon field areas. This, last time I mentioned a line that I couldn't remember what it's called the magenta line. And the site extends out to the magenta line, which is the edge of the U.S. navigable waterways. So site history, I'll try to go through this very quickly. As you all know, these sites up and down the harbors in Boston, New York, doesn't matter, San Francisco, other countries, London, all of these waterfront areas were built out as docks, as piers for shipping, receiving, trade. And throughout the history of this site, there's been a multitude, 14, 15 licenses granted or acts of the legislature granted from the Commonwealth to various landowners of this site. One significant is a license granted from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to the Lewis Wharf Company in 1887. And as you can see, the site of the license that was granted is the current state or the current configuration of the site out to the 1880 harbor line. Even though the fee simple interest of the property extends even further, the license was issued out to the harbor line. And what we want to show in a slide here, this is a historical photo from 1931 showing a lot of the piers and wharfs along the Boston Harbor, along this area. The yellow line here is the 1880 harbor line. The area shaded in
pink. Where's the magenta line?
The magenta line is further out, right around here, probably out another 75 feet beyond that, maybe 100 feet.
is the property line actually earning the edge of the pink out here? Is the, where the magenta line would be? Again, just a more of a tight-range shot of the facility, of the site. And as you can see, these wharfs historically were all built out, essentially covering nearly 100% of the property on these sites. Fast forward, as you all know, the shipping, receiving from the, what was typically done in the 1700s, 1800s changed dramatically in the early 1900s. And waterfronts throughout the country became very rundown, dilapidated, and it really became part of the urban renewal process that folks undertook. And the city of Boston in 1984, under Mayor Ray Flynn, started what they called the Harbor Park Plan. And the Harbor Park Plan was a waterfront planning of the entire waterfront of the city of Boston. And they broke it down into smaller area plans. The particular plan for this site was called the North End Waterfront Plan. And that waterfront planning process was undertaken from about 1984 up through 1990. In fact, the Harbor Park Plan that you'll see in the next couple of slides was adopted as Article 42A on April 27, 1990. That is the underlying zoning for the Lewis Wharf site that stands today. This is the North End Downtown Waterfront Harbor Park Plan, publication in 1989. And as you can see on it here, up here is Battery Wharf, Burroughs Wharf, Union Wharf, Sargent Wharf, down. Here is the Lewis Wharf. Not that any glasses from this far away. Part of the vision, there were 700 community meetings that went on in the Harbor Park planning in the 80s. And various sites, Battery Wharf was designed to be a residential, Burroughs Wharf residential, Sargent's Wharf affordable housing. Pilot House was originally to be housing and some offices that got changed. The Lewis Wharf site was always called out to be, and zoning was put in place for it to be a hotel. This is a larger blow-up of the site. This is what the Harbor Park Plan envisioned for the Lewis Wharf site. 1990, Graham Gunn, a pretty famous architect, had a development company called Gunland Properties. They proposed a project on the site that was fully approved at the end of 1990 by the BRA, and it had a full written determination by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts for Chapter 91 license. This project, as you can see here, incorporated a 335-key Marriott hotel, and the parking garage below grade over here, which is tucked in, was for a 570-car subgrade parking garage. The Gunland project, this is the site plan of it. As you can see here, this is where the current surface parking lot is. The North Pier had a building, hotel built out to here, and it curved back this way, and the South Pier was designed this way. I'll circle back. So since 1992, that project didn't go forward. 1991 was a terrible time in the real estate industry. Most of the banks were out of business. Projects were just basically being taken over by the FDIC, for those of us in real estate back then. It was a pretty dreary time. So essentially, the site's been a surface parking lot since then. Probably preceded that a little bit, but it's been operated as a surface parking lot in the home of the Boston Sailing Center since 1992. And move forward today, nothing's changed on the site. The only thing that hasn't changed, the zoning is still in place. And I will walk you through existing conditions and photos of the site. So again, we're back to our current existing conditions, surface parking lot, pylon fields, area over here, this is the Lewis Wharf pool, And there are some slips, there's a total of 54 slips between the sailing center slips and 22 that is owned by the current landowner, Phil Normandy. And there's additional moorings out there. Total, I believe, 54, if I can do my math. You have that number? 84.
How many surface parks are there?
So the current lot is striped for 163 spaces. The landowner has an open air surface lot license for 223 cars. So if anyone's ever tried to park in this lot, you get valeted in. Sometimes it takes a half an hour to get your car out because they're buried in deep. So he has the right to park. We've been using the word 225, technically it's 223 spaces. I apologize. Let me go through all the slides and then we'll come back to questions.
I just have a slight correction. Sailing center since the 70s.
Say what?
Sailing center since the late 70s.
Yes, but they were in the buildings that were out there. I used to be a member there in 88 and 89. And go out and you look down. So they were out on those old historic buildings, but those buildings are no longer there. And they operate out of that, we call it the River Queen boat. So I'm just going to walk you through some photos of the site. As you know, there are some parts of it are painted green in an attempt to make a harbor walk for folks. This is if you're standing on the sidewalk next to Atlantic Ave looking back towards the entrance kiosk. And this shows when the site gets packed in with cars via the valet system. So, moving forward to our project. Our proposed project, as we said, is fully compliant with Article 42A. We're not asking for any variances. We're not asking for anything that we're going to have to go to the ZBA on and request, something that isn't allowed under the current zoning. Same thing with Chapter 91. We're fully compliant with Chapter 91. We have no offsets or substitutions that we're going to be requesting in the common law. Brief overview of the project. Open space, we're going to be creating 2.39 acres of pedestrian accessible open space. That does include the harbor walk, but that also includes the open space in the parks and areas surrounding the development. We've got approximately 1.25 acres of park land being created at the site. We have 1,800 linear square feet of harbor walk. We are creating a permanent home for the Boston Sailing Center. In fact, as we go through the program, we have about 3,000 square feet designed for the Sailing Center with a marina of 130 slips. The hotel is 190,000 square feet and 277 keys. Parking, we're showing 379 below grade spaces. So one thing I want to note that I don't think we did last time, someone asked a question about FAR. As I say, we're fully compliant with Article 42 in zoning. We have a site that's about 170,000 square feet of terra firma land. Under Article 42A, the FAR here is a 2. So what you do is you take that 179 or 175,000 square feet, you multiply it by 2. So this site, technically, under zoning, could handle a building as large as almost 350,000 square feet.
Are you including the area above the pylons of water as part of your terra firma?
No. No, that's just 179, correct me if I'm wrong, JB.
No, 175.
It does include the body area. So, this is a view, we'll walk you through some renderings. There is the park. There is no park.
Well, the grassy area.
The bowling area.
It's really weird.
I think that's the park to the north.
Yeah.
So, some renderings of the building. The buildings. This is it when we had the picture looking back towards the kiosk.
The kiosk would be standing right around where that is. To the right is the Lewis Wharf Granite Building. To the left is what we're proposing is this park area. You look down the avenue, this is the entry to the Old Cow Building. It's a 55-foot height building. Connecting, there's two piers, so both pier buildings are 55 feet in height. Connected to is a single-story, what we call the connector building, and that's really the heart and soul of the building. That's where the lobby will be. It's going to be glass, see-through to the water, get people into this area and flowing out to the water court terrace area that we're creating.
How tall is that?
It ranges somewhere between 15 to 20 feet. This is a better shot of it. So this is if you're further down, standing in the park, looking out towards these are the current slips, the area of the current slips of the sailing center. Hotel entrance, again, the connector building, and the south pier building. To the right, you see the ramp going down to the garage. Harbor walk, as I said, 1,800 linear feet of harbor walk, 12-foot sides of piers, 35 feet to the end of the pier. This is if you're standing in the sort of the 35-foot section of the north pier looking back towards what we call the water court terrace area. The idea is to have the building flow people outside to the deck here and down to the water and have a lot of publicly, it's all publicly accessible open space.
What's that image in the back?
This? That building?
Yes.
That Lewis Wharf, that's the granite Lewis Wharf building.
All right, thank you.
This is if you're standing essentially on one of the docks, kind of closer up towards Atlantic Ave, looking back. This would be the restaurant entrance along here, connector building, and again, the hotel building on the north here.
Where's the swimming pool on the last shot?
In this shot, it's more to the left, probably right about here where I'm pointing over here. So you'll see that on the site plan momentarily. So this is the proposed site plan, and you're going to see a slide later that shows some differentiations to it, and we'll walk you through that later. But essentially, park area, sailing center pavilion up here, sailing center here, hotel all on the first floor and upper floors here. The pool is being relocated. It currently sits about here, and the pool is being relocated to this area.
Excuse me. The harbor walk, can you kind of walk us?
Yep, so the next couple slides. So I mentioned about 2.39 acres of pedestrian accessible space. That's all this that you see highlighted here around the project. The next slide shows the harbor walk.
Excuse me. All this development that's over the water, we have 15-foot tides here. What's it going to look like at low tide? And how does that affect the total height of the building?
We have 15-foot tides here?
Yes, we do.
Actually, we have about a 6-foot tide here.
No.
9.5 average.
The average is 14. 15, very common.
Yeah, just let him go through the slides. So, sailing center space is here and here. Marina out here. This needs to be, there'll be more work on the marina as we proceed forward. Hotel. One thing we wanted to show on this was the parking garage. This is the first level of the parking garage. So, you come down here. What we're showing in our proposal is all the loading for the hotel is to be done below grade. What this site plan requires is a 12% slope going down to the garage. You cannot bring 36-foot trucks below grade in any slope greater than a 12% slope. So some aerial renderings. So here
ballroom will seat somewhere between 300 and 400 person events. This is where the restaurant will be. And we perceive the restaurant is probably 125, 150 seat restaurant. This is the lobby bar area with seating out on the terrace.
On the water side.
On the water side, yeah. Everything flows to the water side. Yes, as you can see on these both these renderings, it's not a rooftop bar, it's a terrace with that seat. What's that? Height of which building? Both buildings are 55 foot in height. I'm sorry, what?
We can't hear you.
Yeah. She's asking about the rising tide. If you're talking about tide, climate change rising tides?
No, 15 feet is the accurate tide.
No.
No, it's not.
No.
It's average 9.5 feet, and a spring tide comes up to about 12.2.
So let me walk through the rest of the slide.
Well, it's not 6 feet either.
To answer the question succinctly, we're designing the base elevation at 20.5 feet, which is the new FEMA map, Chris, correct me if I'm wrong, proper terminology. That is the new FEMA map adaptation that the city of Boston is doing. Yes, 55 feet are still.
With it,
say
yes.
Can you repeat that, please? The 55 feet. No, you can't, because they're not included in any height calculation.
55 feet from where?
Plus 20?
55 feet of height, starting from a base elevation of 20.5 feet.
Meaning what?
So high above the water, 20.
No. The current base elevation is 17 to 18 feet. So it will start at a base elevation. This is dictated by the FEMA maps in the city of Boston. Okay, we're not allowed to start it at elevation 18. In fact, folks, when we started looking at this project, a lot of projects in the Seaport District are being designed to start at base elevations of 24 feet.
24 feet above the water line?
But
where is that in relation to the water line?
24
feet above the water.
Fair question. I don't know that answer where. So the current high tide is at about 15, right? Maybe 15 and a half feet. So your current high tide, no?
No.
What's current high tide?
All based on Boston water tide, which is zero.
That's your low tide.
It's an elevation marked on a piece of granite someplace, and it is not low tide, it isn't high tide.
It's
zero
Boston mean low
for purpose
water,
of elevation.
Right. But they don't use that anymore.
The FEMA is.
Right. The FEMA adapted. Maps are now the guiding.
But FEMA maps are not tied to Boston City base.
No, that's.
The Boston City base is going to be, the FEMA is recommending, and it's going to be absorbed into the Boston City base.
I think some of us are just trying to understand the relationship between 55 feet and the 20.
It's 55 feet from the grade elevation, so where the building is today. So let's walk through some of the slides, because there's some dimensional requests that address them.
What is 27?
Somebody should ask a question about policy. That doesn't check it. Okay? We're arguing something with terms. Correct?
So again, the last slide we showed you was the buildings that were redeveloped along the piers, built out to the 1880 Harbor Line. And this is the Lewis Wharf Hotel building, built, kind of imposed on what it will look like when completed. So there were some questions and feedback that we tried to address coming back into tonight. The first was kind of a dimensional and height question, and this may help address kind of the height and what that does. When I think of heights, I don't think of where the water is. I think of where kind of the street level is, where Atlantic Ave is, where when you're standing at a building, when you're standing out in the front of the street here looking up at the building, how tall is that building?
And what this city of Boston does is it's from where you are on the ground up to the roof line, which people have correctly said that doesn't include penthouses, that doesn't include your elevator or your stairway overruns. Those do not. So the first study that we were asked, was really some dimensional requests. As you can see, each of the two hotel piers are 66 feet in width, compared to the Grand Building, which is 80 feet, Pilot House, 63 or 65. And then we have dimensional kind of distances from all the various buildings and length of buildings. Anyone have any questions on this slide?
Yeah, I can't read the distance between the end of Lewis Wharf and the lobby by the most...
40, right here, it's 40 feet.
So 40 feet from the east end of Lewis Wharf to the most western part of the construction.
To the connector building, correct. So various height study of the area. We kind of started it over at Battery Wharf and worked our way back towards the project. And I can go through and read these off, but it's probably just as quick as if everyone reads them themselves. But essentially all the buildings in this area start at 57 feet and go up to 130 feet. We show the roof height, which is what I'm saying, the 55-foot height of our building is. And then add the penthouse levels, which all buildings have penthouse levels for mechanical systems, elevator overruns.
Will, sorry, I can't see any of those numbers. I don't know if anybody else can.
No,
you
no.
make these available
yeah.
to us? Because none of this stuff is visible.
Yeah. Being videotaped, and we will. All this will be available via PDF.
Is that commercial wharf on here?
Commercial wharf is on here.
Can you just read us what your penthouse is?
It's high. Right, and it's 61 feet and 64 feet. All right, I'll go through them all. That Battery Wharf, the roof is at 57 feet, with the penthouses to 74 and 75 feet. Burroughs Wharf, 80 feet, and penthouses to 95 feet. 357 commercial. Of course, I don't have my glasses on either, so I get stuck where I sit here.
Get a little closer.
Which is 107 feet to 111 feet. F, 70 feet, G, Pilot House, 80 feet, 90 feet to the penthouses of the Pilot House. H, which is the Grant Building, the Lewis Wharf Condominium Building, 68 feet to the roof and 82 feet to the penthouse. 34 to land is 62. 61 for 83 Atlantic. The Prince Building, 63 Atlantic, is 130 feet, 140 feet to the penthouse. L, which is 50 feet, that's over here. That's 53 feet, 63 feet. And then M is 300 commercial, that's 123 feet.
Just so we understand. These are from a lower base elevation. They're going to be starting at a higher base elevation.
Fair comment, yes. Yes. So the way Boston zoning works, and you know, we're just starting the process. So the way the zoning code works, we're limited to 55 feet of whatever the base elevation, whether it's an average base elevation, I'm not sure how that all works out at the end of the day. What I am saying is, we will be limited to 55 feet from whatever the zoning code requires our elevation to be, our base elevation to be.
Did I miss what you said your penthouse is?
We've not designed our building yet, but I would envision it to be the elevator and stairway overruns to probably be somewhere between probably around 12 feet, maybe 10 to 12. I would suspect the penthouse could be as high as 15 foot.
I
So with that, I'm going to turn this over to Liz, who is our transportation consultant at Howard Stein Hudson. Walk you through the transportation slide. This is Liz, everyone.
And I will try to speak loudly and stand here. So can you all hear me in the back? So again, Liz Pierre at Howard Stein Hudson. We've been working with the team all along here, doing the preliminary transportation work. As Chris had explained at the beginning of the meeting, we are certainly at the beginning of this stage and are ready to file what's called the Project Notification Form, or PNF. So when that document comes out in the next week or so, you'll be able to see that there's a transportation chapter in it. It's a broad overview at this stage of the game of transportation. When we get to the next stage, which is the Project Impact Report, which incorporates everyone's comments, there will be more detailed analysis in that report. But what I'd like to do now is just take a few minutes and talk about what we do know about this site. And our first step in our study is to define the study area, and that means which study intersection are we going to analyze in great detail. And we've identified a preliminary study area that will be reviewed by the Boston Transportation Department and the Redevelopment Authority. We are beholden to methodologies and guidelines that are already established by the city. We'll define that study area in conjunction with the city. We will then collect additional data. We've already collected some data. We'll do more detailed analysis as we get into the future stages. Our focus, as I said in that later stage of the Project Impact Report, will focus on roadways, parking, transit, and the pedestrian environment. A key part of that transportation impact are the number of new vehicle trips. And that's based on, again, guidelines from the city of Boston. So we work with the city to estimate how many new vehicle trips will be generated by the hotel uses and by the restaurant uses that will be on the site. And when we get into that more detailed analysis, we will look at existing conditions and future conditions. It's standard to look 5 years into the future. So we would be looking at 2020 year conditions. And we'll look at a no-build condition, which means everything stays the same as far as our site is concerned, and then a build condition, which would include our project. And we look at the differences to define what the impacts will be to traffic operators.
These city guidelines to calculate the traffic study is the same ones that we used to do with Atlantic Avenue in front of Station and all that area where obviously nobody estimated the city traffic correctly. Like the same methodology?
Well, what we do, generally, yes.
Okay. And that's awesome.
We do live in the rear of but it's very standard to look at existing conditions, what's happening out there now, and what's going to happen, not only from a pedestrian point of view, but a vehicle. And then we'll evaluate those results, quantify what the impacts will be, and that will feed into coming up with improvements if they're warranted. I realize that this is a very difficult map for you all to see. It's an example of a figure from our PNF. It's showing the transit services in the area. Oh, I'm sorry, no, this was defining the study area. So at this stage of the game, this is our site right here, and we've identified four key intersections along Commercial Street and Atlantic Avenue for study. Again, the city will be looking at that and saying, is that the right depth, realm of the study area that we should be studying? Transit services that I mentioned.
The intersection of Atlantic Avenue, where that has the surface road?
No. No, is it Richmond?
why is that?
That's easier.
I mean, it doesn't start in the...
Well, the major intersection is further down.
Yeah, the major intersection is further down, the traffic on that, and it's all community.
And this is a left or right?
I would call it a left, but you certainly have a vision.
You do accept that across the street, yeah.
I don't think that would be... And again, we could certainly work with the city to appropriate some area. What I wanted to do here, we don't have a lot of quantitative information to show you tonight, but I do have some that I wanted to share. So in zooming in on this map, if you look at a point south of our site on Atlantic Avenue, so south of Lewis Wood, along here, the number of vehicles per hour, what are those? And again, I apologize because you're probably not able to see the numbers on this, but I'll explain what this is showing. Along that line across Atlantic Avenue, these numbers represent the AM peak hour during the morning, typically 8 to 9 AM. The blue are representing the PM peak hour, what we probably all traveled through to get here tonight.
What, when were these counts done?
These counts were done within the last year. I don't have the exact date, but I can certainly get it for you.
That
peak
is important.
No, I understand.
Yes. Sometimes
session,
things like that.
In a snowstorm.
We try to avoid when school is out of session, but there are study areas that have unique characteristics in the summer that may lead to wanting to look at two different areas.
Traffic backed up and not moving. How does that affect the camera? Fewer cars per hour.
So I'll just go through these very quickly. So the height of this graph is 550 vehicles. So that is 550 vehicles tall. So during the morning peak hour, that means there are 550 cars about, because it varies day to day, on Atlantic Ave, south of Lewis.
Have you ever tried to drive there yourself?
I have. And
not in the summer, huh?
And the project itself will generate, along this stretch of roadway, an additional 50 vehicles per hour. Under no building conditions without our project, adding in the project, and that's where we would end up for the morning peak hour. And those are the orange ones here. Looking forward to the PM peak hour, as I'm sure we all know, the PM peak hour volumes are higher than the AM. So we need today about 700 vehicles along that stretch. We're estimating we would add 65 vehicles to it for a total of about 17.
Does that include, for example, taxis that would be taking people back and forth to the hotel?
Yes, it does.
And that's only 65
vehicles.
Is a taxi a vehicle?
Yes, I would make a comment about hotels. They are very good development from a traffic point of view. Because unlike retail, which generates many more trips per 1,000 square feet, or unlike office, which generates a lot of trips during the peak hours, a hotel does not have that spiky peak of where we're all going to work at 8 or 9, we're all going home at 5 to 6.
But if you have a functioning room with 300 people, how does that account?
That would be a very narrow band of a lot of cars if you're accommodating 300 people in a function.
Agreed.
So which would be probably in the evening hours.
So the hours here that are defined are the peak commuter hours, which are the highest volumes along Atlantic and commercial. So this is the 5 to 6.
3 o'clock.
How about from 3 to 7?
But there's going to be a time for that. Okay. So could you please hold back on all your questions?
When's the time?
After she's done.
That's okay. It's hard to remember.
Well, then write it down.
Oh, I don't think so.
Just finishing up here, choosing another point. I looked at south of the site, and now looking north of the site. scan again just to see how graphs that are showing the existing traffic volumes, the addition from the project, because not all the trips are going to go in each direction if you think about it. Some are going to go right, some are going to go left. So this is the relative increase north of the site. We did a little comparison to Battery Wharf, which has a hotel, got a parking garage on a long commercial that has a similar capacity. It serves the hotel. It has some public parking.
Thank you.
Has restaurant space, lounge space, event space for weddings, etc. And so we did some counts out of there to give a relative measure of how much traffic the new R project would generate as a comparison to Battery Wharf. So you can go out, anyone can go out and stand at the end of Battery Wharf and watch the number of vehicles that come through in the course of an hour, which is what we did recently. So Battery Wharf, morning peak hour, 100 trips, PM peak hour, about 110. Our project is projected to generate 92, so about 100 in the morning, and 136, a little higher than what we're seeing at Battery Wharf in the PM peak. So from a relative field point of view, and our report won't be based on feelings, our report will ultimately have data and analysis. But based on a feeling of the comparison of these volumes, the impact to traffic operations will probably not be significant. It will be the same as what Battery Wharf generates today.
I'm going to walk through the landscape slides. Let us finish what we're going through. We'll open it up to the IAG, and then it'll be opened up to the public. So one of the other questions are kind of directed to the topic or wanted to provide more information on was the landscape plan. So there's a little bit of difference in the previous site plan that we showed you. Particularly, they had some cross sidewalks coming through the lawn area. We've removed that. We've added a sidewalk coming down here, and I'll get into that in a little bit. It's just essentially, and I know, I forget, someone mentioned trees in front of balconies. What we've done here is the darker gray balconies along here are the third floor balconies in Lewis Court. The lighter gray are the fourth floor balconies. So we've removed some trees. We've tried to place the trees between the taller balconies, or I'm sorry, between the shorter balconies and below the taller balconies. So we're open. If you don't want any trees along that stretch, it doesn't need to be there, but we think it creates a nice streetscape as you come down. But again, we try to really focus the landscape plan to take into account some of those comments. Again, we want to show the water court terrace area here. Again, as I said before, this is kind of the heart and soul of the building will be in this place. And one of the questions that some of the commercial work folks have talked about is noise emanating from the hotel into bedrooms. And the idea of this building is we're programming the entire space to try to focus into our water court area. And by doing so, when we have people out in this area, we have the building here, and the building here, noise is going to reflect out this way and not towards your buildings here, here, and there.
So there's no tables on the south side facing Commercial Wharf?
No.
Everything will be on the inside?
There may be a few smaller ones along the restaurant, so I'm not going to say that we're not having any along there. But what we won't have is any outside bar seating kind of congregating area on the south side.
What about the roof?
The roof is simply a terrace. It's not a bar, but it's a rooftop terrace where people can go and hang out. We're open to putting time limitations on it if it's got to be closed down by
9 o'clock at night or something. We're open to that, but right now the terrace is really for the hotel guests to go get out in the sun and see the water.
No food and beverage?
There's no food. There may be minor food and beverage during the day.
Okay.
But we're just starting this process. So. So I wanted to do a question about the ramp going down, and is there anything we can do to relocate the ramps, to minimize the ramps? The short answer is yes, and we're going to walk you through some alternatives that personally I don't think are great, but this is kind of the existing proposal. Again, I mentioned we have to have a 12% slope ramp going down to the garage to essentially do below grade storage and below grade loading and unloading of trucks. If we reduce, or rather increase the slope to 16%, you can see here we can shorten it by about 35 feet. We can add some park space here. But what this necessitates is a 16% slope ramp, which will only work for cars. All loading would then have to be done one grade above, which I personally don't like, but we were asked to show alternatives, and that's what we want to try to do here. The next slide is, again, the loading below grade with a 12% slope, but doing a ramp off of Atlantic Ave. And it does open up this area here, down by the water in the building, but what it does up here to Atlantic Ave, I'll let you all determine whether you like that or not.
Why is that second roadway necessary? You come this directly into the garage from the Atlantic Avenue. Why is that other paved area necessary?
This roadway here?
Yes.
To get down to the entrance of the hotel, one. Two, the Lewis Wharf condominium building has a 27-foot wide easement there. The purpose of that easement is not only for you to get cars in and out and drop off by your front door, but it's also emergency vehicle access. So you would not want to remove this. Then another alternative is we looked at loading above grade, shortening the ramp off Atlantic, doing a 16% slope ramp here, bringing that down to grade. So one of the comments, or a couple of comments we heard, was that our park doesn't do anything. We're just putting grass down. It doesn't really serve a purpose. So we hear you on that, and we wanted to kind of show you some programmatic approaches to the landscaping plan. We think of this area, and I should go back to the landscaping plan first. What we really think of the landscape area is a series of smaller programmable spaces. So up here by Atlantic, we have some outdoor cafe seating area. We have a lawn area here. We have more seating and lawn area here flowing around. The Harbor Walk outdoor seating area is here. And again, back to a more private kind of garden school area there. So,
excuse me,
first thing, let me finish. The first thing I want to go through and I want to say, we're not comparing the size of our park to that of Post Office Square. We're going to show you some comparisons or some comparables of Post Office Square, but we're by no means saying it's the same size, the same scale, but we think you program the space, you can program it in a similar
question.
Way.
We have a memorial park at the end of by the swimming pool. What will happen to that?
We'll walk through that in a minute. So the park, everyone's familiar with Post Office Square Park, I assume. Anyone have any idea how many ramps go to and from the garage on this park? Four. Four ramps serving a 1,400 car parking garage below grade at this park. So here is a picture taken from a few weeks ago, a nice summer day. Again, we think you can create, what we've tried to do is do a comparable notion of what we can do in a similar area and how the space could be programmed if it was a just kind of a lawn, open landscape, grass area for one of the sections of our landscape programs.
Another area of, that we think could be kind of nice is to do some cafe seating areas on both sides of the Sailing Pavilion building. And it's a similar feel to the pavilion building, the cafe pavilion that they have at Post Office or Park, that does provide some seating for folks. Again, we're talking about the ramps. This is the trellis area and these benches. The folks sitting on these benches are sitting about 4 feet from the ramp, going to one of the four ramps going to the garage. And that trellis area is right along this ramp here. Our idea is to have a very similar kind of concept on this side of the ramp, where you can essentially create a seating and gathering area, as well as creating a screened off area so that you're not aware that the ramp is even there. This is looking at the same trellis, just looking south. You can start to see the fence of the ramp right through some of the foliage there. People sitting in the benches, ramp, and this is basically the screening and the separation for the ramp from the park. I mentioned earlier in the landscape plan, we've added a sidewalk in along the north side of sort of what we call the access road coming down. And the idea of the sidewalk is a couple of reasons. One is if you have a sidewalk and cars on both sides, it becomes more of a pedestrian scale, and that should slow cars down. Another option we can do is put speed bumps along the way, but the thought was putting in a sidewalk, then you can create some screening area and a nice decorative fence on top of the ramp. So I've walked down the sidewalk many a times, and while I know there's a ramp there, I never think of a ramp being there all the time. Again, foliage screening the ramp. And our landscape plan has proposed a very similar type of execution to screen the ramp. So this is the landscape plan again. And I believe that is going to be a couple other program ideas that we wanted to walk through on the landscape. Again, here we show cafe seating areas. Then we show the lawn area, that then flows to more seating and bench areas and screening for the ramps down along the harbor walk, back out to this side of the Grant building. So one of the ideas is we just leave this lawn area, kind of as a lawn area. We have some other ideas we're going to walk you through. Can you kind of give us feedback as to what you'd like to see here?
Nothing.
Other than nothing.
Nothing. Why we're here. I'll tell you what, you don't want to
hear it.
We can do a farmer's market out here. Can
we let Steve?
You don't want to have any idea.
Really, just the IG.
No.
Listen, let's go through the slides.
We have to.
So, other ideas you have? Some interactive, sculpture stuff out on the lawn area that is more than in grass. Again, we flow the building out to the water terrace area. And the idea, as I said, this is the heart and soul of the building, and this is really where the activity is going to be centered for the hotel. And this is the final slide. So I turn it over to Chris.
At this point, I want to talk about
what are you doing with the memorial piece?
We'll get to your questions in a moment. I want to acknowledge Maria Popple from Center for Facilities Office. This is how it's going to work from here on out. This is an IAG meeting again. We are having a public meeting in the near future. We are having a public comment period open up after we put this all on the web. And any questions that you don't get out tonight, you can email me tomorrow morning tonight, and we'll get you an answer as quickly as possible. But the IAG is going to have precedence for asking questions. So at this point, we'll open up to the IAG. If you guys just want to go by a show of hands, we'll go over. Yeah.
Go ahead. I'm Kathy McDonald. I live at 63 Atlantic Avenue, and I'm
not support high-end luxury hotel being built at Mandeville Wharf. As I love our historic residential community, and I know this project will destroy everything we have come to know and love about the North End Waterfront. I want our neighborhood to remain a place where families can raise their children, visitors to envision the harbor as it was in Paul Revere's time, and age-old traditions can remain celebrated and cherished. I'm opposed to this project for two reasons. First, at 55 feet tall, this project would wall off the harbor from the neighborhood. The developers admitted that these buildings would be well over 55 feet tall. By my calculations, with increased allowable base elevation for the new pylons and for mechanicals on the roof, this hotel will likely rise 75 feet above the current pylons. At 55 feet, the harbor would be walled off from the neighborhood. At 75 feet, this luxury hotel will overwhelm our small residential neighborhood, and it will establish a terrible precedence for height and density on historic Boston Harbor. Second, there's no need and there's no demand for luxury hotel in the North Bend. We already have two hotels located within 0.6 miles of each other. We have Battery Wharf and Marriott Long Wharf. Together, they supply 562 rooms. A July 2011 report by the Massachusetts Hotel Association identifies Boston's need for more affordable hotel rooms within a half mile of the convention center, not luxury rooms at the resort. The city needs mid-priced rooms located in the Seaport District. Build your hotel where the rooms are needed. In closing, I'd like to note that IAG members speaking in opposition to this project tonight are not alone. Over a few short weeks, over 600 people have signed a petition in opposition to this project. As we move into the fall and more of our community engages in this process, we expect to sign on hundreds more. I hope the VRA and the developer understand we're not going away. Our opposition to this project is only growing stronger, and we won't rest until the whole thoughtful and appropriate proposal is before us.
This should be on a scale that doesn't harm, but enhances the community area. it says, the plan to develop is designated and will negatively impact the North End waterfront. The developer promises new open space as part of this project, but much of which will be unusable due to the developer's need for parking, which requires two lanes of traffic at the end of the pier, access and turnaround space for emergency vehicles, ramps in, and out of the underground garage. A large two-story service building for the garage and the relocation of the pool. These access roads, in addition to cutting up the new park area, would bring massively increased traffic, in spite of what the traffic people say. Congestion, noise, and pollution, both day and night, to this residential neighborhood. It was my understanding that the site was designated for a public and marine-related purpose, for everyone's enjoyment, not just for those who can afford to frequent a luxury hotel. The North End waterfront is a precious resource and presently allows for the public to enjoy the gardens and extensive views of the water, much of which is now in danger of being blocked off forever. Thank you very much.
Stand up.
Charles Sound, and use this as a temporary load of tires.
North End for 16 years, and I'm very much against this project. I guess it's a massive thing that's going to be built at the end of Lewis Ford, which I think we all agree is a little dilapidated at the moment. But the current owner has been required to make a hover walk for literally decades and has scoffed at the city. And I feel that to reward him for two decades of doing absolutely nothing by a multi-million-dollar payout to build something that I think will make our neighborhood a worse place to live is a mistake. And the size, scale, and massiveness of this construction is out of place for a quiet residential neighborhood. And frankly, the traffic terrifies me. I know you saw studies that say a few more cars, but those are the same studies that gave you South Station. And there's several other plots all right the road. And the DRA, from what I can see, the apologies, is not actually doing anything about traffic studies. The traffic's getting worse. We have gridlock in many places in the city. And if they look at each project alone, and then they put four projects in Sergeant's Wharf and a bunch of other places, we're not going to be able to move in our neighborhood. And that's why I'm here.
I'm Ern Haddad. I'm a retired lawyer. The largest part of my career was at the General Counsel of the National Hospital, where I had many projects with the DRA and was the principal lawyer of the Community Development.
Could you turn this way?
Yes. My family, my father and my brother, real estate developers. I am not anti-development. I am against this project. It's kind of personal for me. When I was a kid, I'm talking 70 years ago, I swam in Boston Harbor. I don't know which wharf my father took us to, my brother and I, but we swam in Boston Harbor off of one of these wharfs. 70 years ago, we bought steel crabs from a vendor, a little street vendor. So I've had this sort of emotional connection to the harbor all my life. The harbor was pretty ugly back then when I swam it. It's changed rather radically over the years, as we all know. And this is a point that I want to make. I've got so many points I want to make, but I'll just make one. And that is that circumstances change. So 70 years ago, when we saw a project like this proposed, I would have been all excited to see those dilapidated buildings go and for a shiny new hotel to go up. But things have changed a lot since then. There's been a lot of development, but the great thing is that the waterfront is opening up in a way that I don't think any of us as old as I, could have anticipated. And that's just wonderful. I walk and I ride my bike through the area all the time. It's just such a pleasure. And I'm just deathly afraid of a project as massive as this. It's just too big. Other people have talked about traffic. Chris has talked about South Station area. This is a piece from the Boston Globe magazine just a few weeks ago. But there's stuff all the time about the gridlock. And it's just so hard for me to believe that our neighborhood can tolerate a project this size without a show. So you just can't. So I'll save the rest of my stuff.
Boston, or definitely the North End, needs a luxury hotel. Personally, I've retired from being Boston's Epcot Center. Every tourist thing in the way. So that's really all I have to say, and I know the piece of my project from Spot.
At our last meeting, I think a lot of these same things were discussed about the height and maybe lowering it and the scale of the project and seeing if it's still economically viable to maybe lower the buildings. I think the last time too, when we discussed the traffic study, we identified that intersection, so it was a little disheartening for me to see it already not in the traffic study that was presented. And people have addressed this, it's a terrible area there now. I'd love to see something like whether it's burying a parking garage and adding green space, but then it just seems like, is there anything that's being discussed with those things since the last meeting?
No, but I apologize about the intersection because I did not pick up on that. My apologies. But in terms of height, look, we're building a fully compliant building project. We're not asking for anything.
I don't mean to interrupt, but like, we all get that. Like, I've sat through two of these presentations, and I understand most people here and they're listening, and they don't want to hear anything they have to say. I'm saying, like, I'm willing to listen to things, except that when I keep hearing that it's compliant, I know that. I'm wondering if you're working with people around there to say, we can still be compliant at 30 feet and still be economically viable.
Well, it's not economically viable.
So it's not. So no. Thank you.
There it is. All right. Good evening, everybody. Go Pats. I have a number of things I want to say, but in the spirit of time, I will keep my comments really short. I didn't really prepare anything. My name is Iffy Mora, and I feel very privileged to be a renter here in the North End. I've been renting here for almost 4 years. I live in 145 Commercial Street. I experience the traffic every single day. And at our last meeting, I had a lot of questions about traffic, and I have to say I was underwhelmed with what I saw today. I do not think that the study that was presented is at all accurate, and I'm not sure. It is not to me, it doesn't feel like it's reality. It doesn't feel like the reality I experience every day with peak hours. And I think overlooking the fact that there is so many rooms, and then there's 300, 400 people in a banquet hall. There's the 60 people in the bar. There's 150 people in the restaurant. There's a rooftop chair. There are going to be a massive number of people coming into the neighborhood, which is great to some people, but when it comes to traffic, I just don't feel like it was totally captured. So I have a lot of questions about traffic. I know you have a lot of data that you can present later, but I'm really concerned about this project because I just think it's unrealistic for our neighborhood. I think it's going to change the neighborhood in a major way. I think it's unnecessary. I agree with many of my colleagues who say that we want responsible development. We don't want pilings as they are right now. Nobody wants that. But we also don't need a project as large as this, as grandiose, and as, frankly, I think with a lot of details left to be figured out. So I'm really concerned. The other thing I would say really quickly is, in our last meeting, we talked about, and you keep bringing up this question about zoning, and I spoke to a number of people I think are very well educated on zoning, and they have a lot of questions. So I'm not completely convinced that zoning is like off the table and not an issue. There are obviously concerns that you're going to have to address in the PNF. So I don't think it's accurate to ask that there aren't zoning issues on this project. The other thing I want to say is that there is an entire plan that the city's doing right now, Imagine Boston 2030. That's the new plan, not the plan from 1990. Mm-hmm. They're working right now on trying to come up with a comprehensive vision, long-term vision for our city. And this is not a part of that right now. So how this connects to a bigger, broader vision, something that makes sense for our neighborhood, that's what I'm looking to support. I don't want us to peg to a plan that was approved back in the 1980s when this city and this area of the city was completely different. So
will have time for that after the file, and we will, inspectional services is the department to say if it's as of right or not. We're not quite there yet. Initial reviews amongst the VRA, and our attorneys view it as compliant, but if you have made a final determination, and you're right, every citizen has the right to question any deals. Okay, Stephen?
Yeah, my name's Stephen. I'm a lifelong resident of North Bend. I live on Cabrosia Street, so I understand the impact that it has, but I feel the same way as John, and if he just cited about traffic, that's my big concern at this point as well. The size of the project is big, but I am keeping an open mind. I have not decided for or against anything at this point. It's too early in my opinion. And I'm just going to kind of wait and see how the plans evolve over time and then make a decision at some point in time. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Richard Whiteman.
I have a lot of concerns about the traffic with this project. I too have not made up my mind. I want to listen, hear, understand, and digest what is said, and I really would rather hear from new people. Thank you.
Hello, David Puccini. I live at 133 Salem Street. I am interested to know, I can see that you don't trigger any warrants or anything with the traffic, but are you willing to do traffic improvements to Atlantic Avenue? Should they be required? Yeah, I think that's part of the process.
As part of this process, we're going to come up with mitigation and community benefits. Traffic will most likely be a part of that. It's just so early in the discussion. We will have ample time for that.
If the vocal majority can give me some kind of information as to why you think this project disconnects Boston from the water.
It's just too big.
Isn't the harbor walk and the park connected to the water? Around the building, the heart and soul, as he said several times, is this connector building, which is going to have, as opposed to Rose Wharf, for example, which has a beautiful opening and invites people to the water, this cuts it off completely. It's lateral from left to right. He says it's 10 to 15 feet high. I don't see how that scale makes any sense based upon the pictures that I've seen. We've also heard in the last meeting that there are going to be restaurants there. Now we hear it's going to be glass, it's going to be open, it's going to be a lobby, it's going to invite everybody in. I don't see that in these pictures. I don't see Rose Wharf here. So that's what walls it off. So if that lobby was penetrable, then you would be.
Expansive water, and there's a beautiful view out over the water. The Rock Haven is there, which is an attractive building, I think. But there's a big expanse, big view. This hotel will lock out
7.20%. As someone who doesn't have an apartment looking out, that is
a view.
From the harbor in.
I don't see that as I walk down.
I will say that in any given day this summer, people are there, sitting there, watching that view.
On the benches.
That's a small part.
But that whole mess is just going to take that view away. I don't see where this is going to really open it up unless you go to the end of the hotel.
I have another very important point to talk about, and that is that I don't know how many of you know that General Lafayette landed at Lewis Wharf with the Hermione. Now, is anything being planned to say something historical about that? Lewis Wharf is a historical building. We have such a point here, and I'm into General Lafayette, I'm wearing the shirt. And when the Hermione was here. But I think it's critical to recognize that this is a historical spot.
owned by John Hancock.
I don't mean to cut you off, but we have a process, and I ask that you please...
Well, you know that.
Thank you for your comments about the connection to the water. Someone mentioned something about a memorial somewhere?
Yes, there's a memorial park right at the end next to the swimming pool.
Is that publicly accessible?
Yes. Oh, yes, it's right there, with a little fountain. It doesn't work.
What is it?
It's somebody's put it up as a memorial. I don't know the name, but it is there.
The last developer.
So you'd like to see that relocated? You don't want to see it go away?
No, okay.
That's all I have.
Between that and Lafayette, I think.
Yeah, two more.
My name is Anna.
I've
lived in the water for over 20 years. I've been elected and served on the Northland Waterfront Neighborhood Council for 20. I'm deeply distressed by this proposal in front of us this evening. Under no circumstances I would support this massive luxury hotel. It would be a disaster to our precious neighborhood. For centuries, to address you, Lewis Wharf has been a place of historic charm for our community and visitors. It's an open space that this development would change the nature and the character of our historic residential waterfront neighborhood. Access to the waterfront would be limited to walking around this massive hotel, which is like the Intercontinental Hotel. It would drastically reduce the residents and visitors to walk along the historic piers. I cannot and will not support this. Now my question to the developer, why does this developer have the right to develop an open water space that has been considered historic for over 200 years? I just don't understand.
It ties back to the Harbor Park. So it ties back to the Harbor Park plan and Chapter 91 license and the 1991 Municipal Harbor Plan. If you look at all the historic piers, Battery Wharf, Burroughs Wharf, Rose Wharf, Intercontinental, Russia Wharf, they've all been built out under Chapter 91 rules and regulations. So it is allowed. Our take is, and there may be different legal opinions, our take is that it's allowed under Chapter 91.
We'll find out.
Hi everyone. I'm going to be quick. I said a lot at the last meeting, and I know my husband is really interested in getting home to watch the Patriots. So, before I get into the comments I had prepared, I just wanted to tie back to the Keogh Square thing. Well, that park, by the way. But Keogh Square is in the middle of the financial district. It's in the middle of a commercial zone. It's not in the middle of the neighborhood, and it's not over ocean. So while I get the spatial comparison, I don't know that I really want to, it's a different thing. And Keogh Square, again, is in the middle of a commercial zone. So, I do not and will not support a proposal for a large scale luxury hotel in Lewis Wharf. Just want to be clear about that. As parents, as a young family, we've lived here for 12 years now and plan to continue doing that, as our forever home. We're interested in keeping the neighborhood a neighborhood and not a congested commercial zone. I'm really concerned that this development would have an indelible negative impact on our historic residential neighborhood. I'm going to skip all this other stuff that I wrote because I just want to make an important point. What I think we really need to focus on here and what the community needs to really voice their opinions on is that while the developer says they can develop this project, which we may or may not agree with, does not mean that they should. We need to think about what they can. We need to talk about what's right for the neighborhood and not just what can be done. So please keep that in mind as we go forward to this process. I also just wanted to make a point about hotel rooms. A lot of this seems to be based on Boston needing hotel rooms. There's some recent news reports in July that there are 23 hotel projects currently underway. Most of it new, a few are rehabs. It's a total of 4,700 rooms that will be placed in service by 2017. With that data going on and that stuff already underway, these are projects that are happening right now. I don't see the need to triple the number of hotel rooms that are going to this project.
I just want to give people an idea of the timing, okay? The BRA, even if they allow this, that's step one. There are, if, by the way, if our attorney was here, she would say you absolutely have no right to listen. She explained why, but I heard that. After, even if there is approval, there's a process that you should know about. There are 10 or 12 or 15 other places to stop this project. Even if that happens, let's say 6 years from now, then you begin your litigation, because there is a case that applies to this very spot that doesn't apply to anywhere else in the city that says you can't do it. That will take 5 years, and the Supreme Judicial Court, the highest court, after they go through the Superior Court, and then they go through the appeals process, and then they drag us, we're spending millions of dollars, and so are you. I can't understand why you want to do this, the developers. I don't get it. Because we're talking 10, 12, 14 years, and at the very end, you've got this case that says you can't do it. Now, I was president of the Bar Association in this state. I've talked to 20 judges about this. I've talked to more than that in terms of specialists of practice. Now, I know you have your lawyers. They all tell you the same thing. It'll be a long, expensive process. I hope you don't have to go through and then you win in the end. We don't want to wait till we all spend in assessments millions and millions of dollars. We don't want you to waste your money either. But you're going to go through that whole process and drag this community through, and you're not going to engender any friendship. You're going to be despised throughout the process. Why not? You asked us to keep an open mind. I'm asking you all to keep an open mind. Why not go back to your principles and say, hey, we can be the hero here. We can see that this community is clearly against it, and we clearly are. Okay? And you can see that you're going to have a long and expensive fight with this unique thing you have never had in any other real estate development any of you have ever been involved in your lives. A very unique case. I know there are better legal minds than mine about it, but I discovered it. Here it is. One of our attorneys. And by the way, we don't just have our paid-for attorneys. We got a dozen firms, including mine. I'll work for free. I'll work for free for 20 years to make sure this never sees the light of day. It won't. But why drag us through it, and why drag yourselves through it? People should look at this case. It says you cannot build a hotel there. Believe me. Trust me.
All right.
As I understand it, Battery Wharf Hotel was just sold because it was failing and wasn't living up to the expectations of what it would become. I don't understand why, if Battery Wharf Hotel is failing, we think, or you think, that another hotel 6 blocks away or 6 floors away will succeed. It just makes absolutely no sense to me among a thousand other things that could come up.
Answer?
Is there an answer to why Battery Wharf failed? Or
come on, give us an answer.
Well, I don't know the answer. I know it's
sold. Well, you should. Damn well should.
How can you build something and not look what happened down the street in Poplar?
My name's John Shad. I lived at Commercial Wharf for about 10 years. I have a question on your landscape plan. It shows extensive marina facilities on the east, north, and south side of your proposed project. The question I have is, who would control that marina if it were to be constructed, as far as the administration of it? And also, what sort of access, vehicular access, would you have for those, the mains and the fingers and the docks of that marina. It doesn't appear to be any space to actually access that marina area. Did I miss something or?
Yeah, where the current surface parking lot is, that's going to be dropped below grade to create the above level park. And below grade will be 379 parking spaces. So that's where Marina Mason will park. We've not gotten far down the road at all as to who's going to manage the marina, so we don't know. A significant amount of the slips will be actually for the Boston Sailing Center. So they will manage their own slips.
But I'm talking about the private group.
Yeah, there'll be other additional slips that will be rented out to the public. And there's been no, you know, thinking as to who's going to manage it at present.
All right, thank you.
Yes, Eileen Blackstone, I live on Commercial Wharf. In addition to the traffic and just how incredibly massive this building is and will cut off views from the waterfront, I have real concerns about noise and the use of the space. You know, we live across the park from Tiers and the Marriott, and the noise that emanates from that establishment across the park is very, very loud. And you're talking about, you know, restaurants, outside space, a banquet hall, a roof deck, etc. Basically next door to Lewis Wharf and Commercial Wharf. So I guess I don't really buy that the noise is just going to go into your central core, because we already live and experience that the noise permeates all across the water. So that's another real concern of mine. And I don't want to hear 9 o'clock at night. I don't want to sit outside of my house at 6 o'clock and have to hear the noise, let alone at 2 o'clock in the morning, because I live with that now too.
They won't do it. And the people spoke and they went away. And now they're back. So I'm confused. That's not to you.
So, John,
I know.
So what, at this time last year, we met with the various Commercial Wharf, Lewis Wharf, Prince Building folks to talk about the same looking project, but it had a larger, it had a residential.
No, he's talking about something else.
No,
with all respect, he's talking about, it's on video.
Yeah.
It was a promise made to this community that you developers would not do it if it was against the will of the community. It's on video.
The community is larger than just the building.
I know, but you're getting a sense of who the community is.
Let me I can finish what, so we talked about doing a part residential and part smaller hotel project. And as I said to folks were at those meetings that are in this room, and what we said at the time was we don't have the right to do that. We need basically unanimous support by the immediate abiding buildings and the community as a whole to have the city want to put forth what we require would be a municipal harbor amendment. And we were not provided that support. And at the time, in all those meetings for the folks that were in those hearings, we said, look, what we believe, and we could be wrong about this, what we believe is by right, or not by right, we are essentially fully compliant with Zone 91 to build a hotel project. And what we said is it may be us and it may be someone else. Someone eventually is going to build a hotel on this site. That's our opinion. I mean, you're wrong.
Line your life.
So to answer your question, though, Dan Toscano, who I believe he's not here, I don't think. What he
Dan
said
made the
was,
promise. Dan made the one who made the promise on video.
That's what I'm saying. Dan Toscano said we are withdrawing our any presentation to NURA about the residential and hotel development because it wasn't going to go anywhere. So
it's
there's
not going to go anywhere. So it was only the residential. Specifically
about the residential.
Don't play it back. We're going to play it back. He said, if we didn't want a hotel in this neighborhood, we weren't going to have a hotel in this neighborhood. That's what you're representing. We put it on the video. It's clear.
Okay. Any last questions before we wrap up? Be expecting an email from us. We'll be up on the web next week.